Christianity is authentically supernatural. It's naturally supernatural. In fact, you can't divorce the two. You can't divorce true Christianity from the supernatural because it is supernatural. Amen? It all started, you know, with, God. Amen? God. How can we take the supernatural out of this thing? God's here, the supernatural's going to be here. Amen? And I believe, you know, what I experienced was an awakening. Whenever you begin to awaken to something, you begin to become stirred. And usually there's a discontentment. But, you know, don't consider the discontentment at times, you know, something to be, you know, rejected, something to be dismissed. A lot of times that discontentment is the Lord stirring you up and beginning to speak to you that there's more. Yes. Amen? There's more. Yes. If you're not hungry, if you don't find yourself being hungry and at times feeling somewhat empty, it means that there's nothing left to fill you with, right? I think there's plenty of Christians today, they need to just empty themselves and say, you know what, I haven't arrived. You know what? You know, I do need more. And you know what? I need to get hungry. Amen? I need to get desperate. I know there's a wonderful grace movement in the world today. It's moving all over the place. And I love the grace movement. I've been impacted by it. You know, the finished works of the cross. And Jesus did it all. And therefore, I've arrived. Praise God. But you know what? I like what Paul, what my friend Todd Bentley says. Until my shadows heal in the sick, I have room to grow. Amen? Come on, somebody. Until I open up the good book. Like my bad now, but I do have my Bible over there. Got all my notes here. But until I open up that good book, and you know, I'm living everything in it, I got room to grow. I got somewhere I'm going. Amen. Amen. How many of you guys with me? So that's my testimony. I begin to be stirred and just hunger for the supernatural. And I found myself in one of my friend's house at 17 years old, and I was sitting on the couch and this TV show came on that I'd never seen before, and this guy in a white suit comes out. But you guys knew I'm talking about. On the TV, and regardless of what you think about Benny Hinn, I honor that man as well, because he is literally, his ministry is responsible for introducing millions of people like myself to the power of God. Amen? Even my friend Todd Benny, who I'm ordained under now, was introduced, you know, to the power of God. Then again, the first book he ever read was Good Morning, Holy Spirit by that man. That book has touched more people, I'm telling you. And Todd, you know, before just a baby Christian, thought it was normal to just go in your room and pray all day and spend time with the Holy Ghost. You know, what would all of the church be like if they all started out their walk with Jesus just spending hour upon hour upon hour upon hour every day with the Lord? Amen. I'm telling you. Get some wells dug there. Yes. Amen. Get some foundations established. Amen. Strength. Amen. Yes. Whew, hallelujah. Glory on that. Yes. But I watched this man come out on the stage, and, you know, young man, you know, judgmental. You know, I was like, who is this guy? This funny accent, you know, the suit, you know. And I was just, you know, totally judging up front. But then I saw the anointing move.
Yeah, yeah. There you go.
And then something went, and I'm like, that's what I've been looking for. Yeah. That I've been hungering for.
Thank you, Lord.
The Word of God, not in just word only, but in power. Demonstration.
Yes.
And then I saw this man do the most peculiar thing. He grabbed the mic like this, almost like he'd been struck by something. How many of you guys have ever been struck by the power of God? Spitting in, you know, in his own servants, his own, you know, mega crusade thing, right? He grabs the mic, and he's like struck, and he just falls over, just backwards on his own platform, and he was healed that day. This was 2002. He was healed of a heart arrhythmia, of a heart issue he'd had for 3 years on his own platform. Now, it wasn't a big miracle. I mean, like some people would say, it's a big miracle to him. I mean, you guys know all miracles are big. But it wasn't like one of these, you know, the guy came flying out of the wheelchair or blind from birth. Oh, I can see. It was, you know, a heart thing, and there was no doctor there, you know, testing him. But how many of you guys know that the witness of the Holy Ghost is a real thing?
Yeah.
It's a powerful thing. And in my opinion, it's the strongest witness.
Yeah.
It's the strongest evidence.
Yes.
The Holy Ghost comes and gives this thing called faith, which is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not yet seen. Amen?
Yeah.
Holy Ghost gives that.
Yes.
So that day, I have the evidence, I have the witness, I have the substance. What I just saw was real.
Yes.
It cut through all my judgmentalness. It cut through all my, you know, seeing it all face value. And I saw a miracle, and it changed my life. It sent me down a path of hunger, desperation, searching. I mean, I was so immature in the things of God at that time. I remember I was running my local Bible club at that time, the local campus club. And I kid you not, I started wearing all white to every one of the Bible club classes. And it was hilarious, you know? Because, you know, I don't know. I mean, maybe there was something about it. I mean, all I knew was that I wanted that. I wanted an encounter. I wanted the Holy Ghost to use me. And I'm telling you, there's a fresh generation that's rising up that's saying, you know what, where is the God of Elijah? Where is the God of Oral Roberts? Where is the God of T.L. Osborne? Where is the God of William Branham? Talk about this guy a lot. Incredible demonstration of the Spirit. Incredible miracles, signs and wonders. Voice of healing released even in this country a generation ago. Where at any given time you could find tents set up all over this country. And the power of God, the blind seeing, the deaf hearing. It was said that in one of Jack Coe's meetings, over 100 people came flying out of the wheelchairs in one meeting. One meeting. You know, a lot of people have a lot of things to say about my spiritual father, Todd Bentley, but I got a lot of respect and a lot of honor for this man. After he went through restoration after Lakeland, the first meeting that he did on the road was in a place called Reno, Nevada. And he was on the platform ministering, and a lightning bolt from heaven struck him on the platform. It was actually caught on camera. You can find the picture out there. It's on my Instagram for like 2 years ago. But literally, power of God struck him, and the moment the lightning bolt hit him, 16 people got up out of the wheelchairs in the front row. Instantaneously. But you know, there was a meeting that Jack Coe did. In one meeting, more than 100 people he pulled out of the wheelchairs. And, you know, I was listening to one guy a little while ago that's considered a premier healer in our day. Premier healing ministry. And he was on a TV show. And this person asked him, how many people have you seen come out of wheelchairs? He said, two. Over his entire ministry. I praise God for those two.
Yes.
I'm not pointing the finger, and I'm not, oh, you know, you're so low. But there's like a part of the church that's like, it feels like they've arrived. Right?
Yes.
It's like we've arrived, we have the gospel of grace, we're there. But you know what? I see a gap there. 100 wheelchairs in one service, two over your entire ministry, and you're a premier healer. Now, once again, I'm not condemning, I'm not criticizing. I'm recognizing something that, you know what? The glory of God is not supposed to diminish from generation to generation. It's supposed to increase. It's supposed to be thrown forward. The mantle is supposed to be passed on to the Elijahs. And when it's passed, it's supposed to be doubled. That's the nature of mantle passing. It's supposed to be doubled. The cave that Abraham bought in the book of Genesis, in which he began to bury, you know, himself, and he didn't bury himself, but he bought it for the burial of him and his wife and his children. It was this burial plot, this cave called Machpelah, which means double portion in the Hebrew.
Come on.
So from the very beginning, even with the father of our faith, there was a declaration made over the passing from one generation to another. Double. Double portion. Double. God, what you did with the prior generation, you're going to double on the next generation. And until the Lord comes, it's just going to keep increasing. It's just going to keep increasing. It's not supposed to get darker and darker in the church. It may get darker and darker in the world. It's not supposed to get darker and darker in the church. It's supposed to get lighter and lighter on the day. It's supposed to get brighter and brighter. The anointing, the glory of God, is supposed to get heavier. It's supposed to get thicker. Amen? So God's put a message in my heart. And he's saying, you know what? If Jack Coe pulled 100 people out of wheelchairs in one meeting, I'm going to pull 200 at least.
Yeah.
Bare minimum.
Come on. Yeah.
Standard. That's my floor. Bare minimum. I'm going to pull at least 200.
Amen.
My spiritual father, Todd Bentley, he pulled 30 out in Lakeland in one night. More than 30 people raised from the dead. I'm sure you guys have heard some of these stories. Last year, he saw 3 people raised from the dead in Pakistan. In a crusade that led 300,000 Muslims to the Lord. People can say what they want to say about the man. But you know what? God's raised him up as a forerunner. And I want what he has. Amen. And I want to see God take that anointing, that same anointing that's been on prior generations, and multiply that even double for my generation. Yes. Double the anointing. Can somebody say amen to that?
Amen.
But we got to get hungry for it. We have to have an appetite for the supernatural.
Yes. The
Bible says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst. Those are the ones that are going to be filled. Yes. Amen? Yes. You're not being filled? Let me ask you, how hungry are you? How desperate are you?
I don't need to be desperate. I'm satisfied in Christ. I have all things in the finished work.
Yeah, it's true. I do. I am the fullness, the Bible says. Ephesians 1:23, we the body of the fullness of Christ in the earth. Seated at the right hand of the throne right now, the Bible says. Seated with Him in glory. Above every principality, power, authority that can be named. I understand my positional authority just as much as the next person that's got a Bible. But you know what? I'm hungry for the manifestation of the thing I claim to believe. Too many people grab the positional truth and they stop there, and they don't demand the manifestation of the thing they claim to believe. In my Bible, faith brings the substance. Faith brings the reality. It doesn't just bring agreement for the doctrine. It doesn't just bring agreement with a scripture. Agreement is the start.
Right.
Agreement opens the door. But the word was always meant to be flesh.
Amen.
The word was always meant to be flesh in your life. It was always meant to be a reality.
Right.
You should be eating the bread of healing, because the bread of healing is available through Jesus today.
Yeah.
You should be eating and feasting on the bread of deliverance, because Jesus is here today. He is that bread that came down.
Come on.
Yeah. Amen. We, the church in America, should be feasting on the bread of revival. Feasting on the bread of manifest presence. But you know what? I think a lot of the church is just not hungry. They're not hungry. They've been satisfied with other things. They've filled themselves with other things. The age which we live in, there's all kinds of ways to tickle our senses.
This is true.
Satisfy us, you know? We watch, you know, just the click of a button. I mean, it doesn't even hardly cost anything. I got this app, you know, on my thing here, this Netflix app. I mean, for $8 a month, you have access, and each one of these productions is millions of dollars. I mean, we're talking quality entertainment at the cheapest of cheapest prices. You know how many people have been bought out for $8 a month? You know how many people's desires have been bought out for $8 a month? Now, I've got the app on my iPad that I preach from. So I'm not bashing anybody that's got Netflix. Watch TV. That's not what I'm doing. What I'm saying is, how hungry are you for God?
Right.
Come on now.
And what are you willing to click off at times
so
you can tune in?
Come on.
Because you know what? Many times we miss because we're not tuning in.
Yeah.
It's that simple.
Yeah.
It's not because it's not available.
Right.
It's not because God said no. It's not because He hasn't provided it. He has provided it many times. It's because we don't care enough. We're not hungry enough. Amen?
Yeah.
You know what? I want to suggest to you, at times, you have to position yourself for hunger. You have to rearrange some things in your life to say, you know what? I'm going to be hungry.
Yes.
Even if I don't feel hungry,
right,
I know there's more. Therefore, I'm going to reposition some of my schedule. I'm going to reposition some of my time. I'm going to be at that next prayer meeting
on
Wednesday, right? Wednesdays?
Yeah, and Tuesdays.
And Tuesdays. You know what? I'm going to get up a little earlier this next week before I go to work. I can remember a time I was so desperate for God. I'm telling you, that's the key.
Yeah.
That's what bridges the gap. You begin to hunger and thirst, you're going to be filled with the Lord. You're going to start to be filled with the glory.
Yeah.
I have an incredible realm of the seer around. I have an incredible realm of visitation. I was visited 4 different times by the Lord Jesus last year. Just last year. What do you guys like?
Yeah.
Well, let me tell you some of my history that led to that. There was a time as a young man, I was getting up at 3 a.m. every morning.
Amen.
I made a commitment for a season. I was going to pray 4 hours every day.
Come on.
And I had to get up in the morning, 3 a.m., start my day, because around 6 a.m., 7 a.m., I'd get ready for work, and then I'd go do 12 hours of construction work. Even though I was young, I was still worn out when I got home.
Yeah.
There's some practicality in this, you know? do it, you know, where you know you're going to be able to do it. Right? But there is something about that. There is something about getting up early.
Right.
Sacrificing that time.
Yeah.
The Bible says in Mark chapter 1 that Jesus rose a great while before the day broke.
Yeah.
Scholars say it was actually 3 a.m. It was the third watch that he rose and began to pray.
Wow.
Some people believe that was his regular
yeah.
prayer schedule. Because, you know, he had a lot to do in just 3.5 years of ministry.
Yeah.
Right? He had a full day. But he got up to spend that time with the Father. I was up spending that time with the Father in 2007. And then one of those days, I'm up, you know, and in those days, I used to pray on my knees for hours. And the reason I did that is because I didn't want to fall back to sleep. I always fall back to sleep. Sometimes an angel will come up and smack me when I fall asleep. I'd be like, all right, I'm up. And, but one of those times I was up praying and the Lord Jesus appeared to me in the room. February 22nd, 2007, he appeared as a 12-foot tall giant in the room. And he didn't say nothing. He didn't really do nothing. He just stood there, and then all of a sudden, he walked forward and walked right into me.
Amen.
Walked right into me. And I actually, if you can believe this, I felt the Lord turn around inside of me and then sit down on the throne.
Glory.
And I heard all of the voice of God say, I've enthroned myself within you. The scripture is Isaiah 22:22.
Right.
The Lord said. And it was February 22nd, 2007. There's 4 2s in that name.
Yeah.
So I looked it up. It says, he shall lay upon his shoulder the key of the house of David.
Yeah.
He shall open and none shall shut. He shall shut and none shall open. We've all been praying for the revival that never ends.
Right.
The revival that never fizzles out.
Right.
Well, that's what happens when the key of David is accessed. And the door stays open.
Glory to God.
The gate stays open.
Yeah.
When the gate stays open, you have Psalm 24. The King of Glory keeps coming
yes.
in.
Right.
The King of Glory.
Yes.
Mighty and strong. Mighty in battle. He is the Lord of hosts.
Yes.
He is the King of Glory.
Yes, He is. Yes,
amen.
He is.
We can access gates in our day with the key of David, which
yes.
comes out of intimacy with the Lord. Amen.
Yes.
We can access gates, not just revival gates for the church, but we can access governmental gates.
Yes.
We can access principal gates of finance that have been right. occupied by the enemy for generations.
Yes.
Because a lot of the church hasn't placed any value on those gates.
Right.
Right.
They've been convinced that the Lord's just going to burn the earth anyway, so who cares? But actually, it's a part of our inheritance. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness
yes.
thereof and its resources.
Yes.
And
yes.
each shall inherit the earth.
Yes.
Yep. And what the church has not inherited, has not taken hold of in their inheritance, the enemy has been happy
there
to possess.
Yeah. Yeah.
And thoroughly financed his work.
That's right.
But the enemy's plans and agenda is going to begin to be choked off in this generation
That's
more
right.
than any other generation
That's
that we've
right.
seen.
Amen.
Yep. And the work of the kingdom of the earth is going to be more financed than we've ever seen.
Yes.
Right. Very well transferred. Yes. But it's going to come through the church awakening to the reality that this is actually a part of our
inheritance
that Jesus provided.
Yep.
Amen.
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 So that's where this revelation began to be awakened to me. The first verse there, Isaiah 22:22, it says, the key of the house of David will be put upon his shoulder, will lay upon his shoulder. He shall open and none shall shut. He shall shut and none shall open. So that's heaven's authority.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
But then in verse 23, it says, and he shall be for a glorious throne unto me.
Oh.
It literally says that right there in the verse. I'm going to make him the throne of God. What does it mean to be made in the throne of God? What happens when God comes and sits on you as his throne? Well, that's the weight of his glory coming on you. But that's the weight of his glory for government.
Come on.
That's the weight of his glory for authority.
Yeah.
To open up gates that never shut again. To shut the enemy's gates, have them never open again.
Come on.
I'm hungry for that.
Come on.
I'm hungry to see the globalist spirit kicked out of this country and never have the gate opened again.
That's right. Amen.
Come on.
I'm hungry to have the the gates of the Antichrist just come through, the Antichrist spirit, right? Because it talks about that. I'm hungry to have those gates shut and then have the gates of the kingdom of Christ open. Amen.
Yes.
Permanently open. Let the King of Glory come in.
Yes.
That's what I'm praying.
Amen.
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 Amen. So, I'm hungry for a reality of the kingdom.
Yeah.
Amen. I'm hungry for the reality of what generations that have gone before us have seen That's really been an example. It's been a picture of what's available, but it's been a picture of what God's going to increase, what's going to multiply.
Amen.
Recently, the Lord spoke to me about the mantle of Billy Graham. I saw the mantle of Billy Graham double and carry forward.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Interestingly enough, I saw the largest portion of it coming on the African American community in our country. Amazing revelation. I have a heart for African American community in this country. They're going to be raised up more than ever before. The enemy has exploited this, taken advantage of it for generations, and many of those gates are going to be closed in this generation. Amen. I saw the mantle of Kim Clement going forward. Double. Amen. I actually saw right after President-elect Trump was elected, I actually saw this vision, and the Lord said, the eagle has landed, now the prophet will soar.
Glory.
And the Lord is beginning to speak to me about the kind of governmental authority even that Kim Clement moved in as a prophet that would prophesy to presidents.
Yeah.
The Lord began to speak to me about that multiplying.
Amen.
And I saw these two peacocks come together. I know this is strange, but this is just weird stuff that Seer sees, so just go with me. I saw these two peacocks come together, and then they became a double portion peacock, a massive peacock, and then it flew away. I mean, it was like, it sounded like a helicopter taking off. It was so mighty. Normally, peacocks can't fly like that. This thing shot off through the heavens, you know, like an eagle. Now, in case you're wondering, the peacock is a representation of the seer prophet.
That's right.
Okay, the seer, because they have those feathers that look like they have eyes on them, right? And the eye is all about is the gift of discernment. Seers have discernment. The Lord spoke to me very clearly early in November. And he said, I'm going to take the mantle of Bob Jones, seer prophet, and I'm going to take the mantle of Ken Clement, a Navi prophet that moved powerfully in that inspirational flow. Would prophesy out of that inspiration, right? He even prophesied Donald Trump's presidency back in 2007. Powerful anointing, very accurate. The Lord spoke to me, he's going to take those two mantles, put them together, and produce a double portion prophet in the next generation for America. And the prophetic voice, the prophetic authority is going to grow even in the media mountain, even the news establishment mountain, even in the governmental mountain. And I'm telling you, this is what my heart burns for. I pray 2 Kings 6, where it says that the king of Assyria came together and he was mad at all his generals. He said, which one of you has betrayed me? And they say, we haven't betrayed you. He said, then why does the king of Israel know everything I've been telling you in the private? And they said, it wasn't us, please. Let us keep our heads. Of course, I'm paraphrasing. They said, it wasn't us. It was that prophet Elisha. Everything you've been saying behind the scenes, behind closed doors, he tells it to the king of Israel. I'm believing for that anointing to hit government. That something can come before on our president's desk from the CIA that's not of the Lord. And he'd say, hey, prophet, you, come here. Is that the Lord? Oh, not the Lord? All right. I mean, why not? Why not? You see, this is what God's doing right now. He's stirring us up. He's giving us a new dream. He's giving us a new vision. With the new vision comes a new faith. With the new faith comes a new expectation. Through the expectation of the church, doors are open for a new manifestation of the kingdom to come forth. We've not been expecting. Much of the church has just been expecting for the Antichrist to rise up and rule everything and then, you know, have to, you know, try to keep their heads for 3 years. There's not much faith in that. What does that produce? But, you know, the book of Revelation opens with Jesus saying, I am the Alpha and Omega, I'm the beginning and the end. And Jesus is not going to be king any more tomorrow than he is now. He's not. But you know, much of the church doesn't believe that, what I just said. Much of the church believes that he'll be king more in the millennium. And that he's not allowed to be king until we get to the millennium. But you know what I believe bridges the gap between our current manifestation and the manifestation then? I believe what bridges the gap is how me and you receive him right now.
Yes.
How we receive him now as king, not just priest, but king.
Yes.
And how we manifest him through us.
Yes.
As king.
Yes.
The Lord is beginning to stir up a new vision, a new dream.
Yes.
That yes, we can take the seven mountains.
Yes,
yes, we can take the mountains of influence.
Yes,
yes, we can see the prophetic voice.
Yes.
Fill the governmental mountain.
Yes.
Fill the White House.
Yes.
Fill, you know, those roles of the counselors of governmental leaders.
Yes.
That yes, we can take back the principal gates, even of finance.
Yes.
And see the great harvest that we've all been dreaming about actually happen.
Yes.
Actually come in.
Yes.
Actually be financed.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, God.
So much of my heart right now.
Yeah, come on.
But I'm going to land this. Bear with me. I'm going to land this.
Amen.
We are going to be back tomorrow, tonight. What time is 6?
6
p.m. tonight. And I'm telling you, you're not going to want to miss tonight because there's been an extraordinary realm of miracles, signs and wonders, gifts of the Spirit moving. I was just in Visalia. Is that how you pronounce it? Visalia? On Friday. And we had some crazy words of knowledge and miracles. The first word of knowledge I pointed to a woman on the right side, and I said, there's someone over here that has a scar on this knuckle right here. And sure enough, out of a crowd of I don't know how many, a woman came up right out of the section I called out, had a scar right there. And it's that level
yes.
of razor sharp discernment. I looked at another woman, I said, the Lord shows me that you either have now or you've had at one time, bowels, a twisting of the bowels.
Mm.
She comes up and she says, 20 years ago, I have this massive scar right here. I had surgery for the twisted bowels, IBS.
Right.
And I said, the Lord says, Benjamin, I hear the name Ooh. Benjamin, and I see you prophesying over Benjamin as a baby. She began to weep. She began to cry. Mm. And she said, my grandson that's been lost for all these years, they took him away. I didn't know where he was. His name is Benjamin. And when he was a baby, I prophesied over him. I prayed over him. And I've been praying over him ever since. Something happened with her son, and he was taken away and ended up in the system, ended up out of state, something like that. But you know, I spoke directly to her. And I received several names that night. There was one woman that I prayed over her. I called out a broken nose. And she said she literally felt her nose begin to twist and begin to move. She said it changed. The structure of it changed, and her breathing was over. Create a miracle. There's another man that I'm meeting, 100% deaf. 100% deaf. His ear open. There were so many. The anointing was just so razor sharp. There were so many I just called out. Just pointed them in the crowd. Called out their condition. Names of their grandsons. Their children. But I say all that not to boast. I say all that to say I'm excited.
Yeah.
Because the anointing's intensifying.
Yes.
Amen. The gifts of the Spirit are not getting duller. They're getting sharper.
Yes.
Amen. They're getting sharper.
Yes.
I read about a man named William Branham in the previous generation that had such an extraordinary gift of discernment, prophet's discernment, that Gordon Lindsay, the founder of Christ for the Nations, had this testimony about this man. He said that when Branham said that he saw a vision, if he called you out and said, I see a vision of the Lord, Gordon Lindsay said that when Branham saw a vision, he was never wrong.
Right.
He never saw him miss it. 100% accuracy.
Right.
Some people would say, I don't believe a man can do that. I believe only God can, and I would agree with you.
Yeah, that's right.
That's beyond just the gift of the Spirit. That's beyond the ability of man.
Yeah.
That's the manifestation of Christ
Amen.
Coming through people.
Yes. Yes.
Well, I'm telling you, saints, Branham was just a teaser. Branham was just a prototype, a picture of what God would bring forth in an entire company,
yes.
an entire generation. I call it the glory generation. I call it the glory gifts coming forward.
Yes. Yes.
And they're going to move in a realm of the Spirit that seems unlimited.
Right.
Yes.
It's going to seem unlimited flow. There'll be times they'll prophesy, and it seems like they know everything about you.
Right.
Of course, it's God, right?
Right?
He knows every hair on your head. He has a number.
Right?
Right.
Right.
But what level of that God can we see manifest through us? Amen?
Yeah.
I'm believing for more.
Yeah.
Amen. Believing for more?
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
So why don't we come here tonight in faith and believe for more together?
Amen.
Yeah.
Tonight. Amen.
Yeah.
I'm believing with your pastors. I'm believing with this congregation for a fresh move of God.
Yeah.
I'm believing for what God's promised.
Yes.
I'm here in the region. I'm a visiting evangelist, but I'm pulling on the well. I'm pulling on the prophetic words. I'm calling for every word that God's released in this place, and I'm saying, Lord, do it. Lord, bring forth the harvest of the seed that you've sown. The seed as it goes forth, or excuse me, the word as it goes forth like seed. And the Lord is the Lord of the harvest. And he always makes good on the seed. Amen. He always brings forth the harvest in due time. So that's what we're believing for. I'm going to go after miracles tonight, to prophesy over people. I'm probably going to open up to this realm that's been open to me too, that I call financial glory. I'm releasing two books actually this year called Financial Glory. One of them is Financial Glory, operating in Financial Glory in America, Israel, the nations. Amen. That's the first book that's going to be released. I've received several prophecies, even about America and about Israel, the restoration even of our economy in this country.
Amen.
Before Trump was elected, actually, right around the turn of the Jewish New Year this last year, I was visited by a guardian angel that guards over U.S. presidents. Amen. And the presence of this angel, I had several visions where the Lord spoke to me very, very clearly and gave me key information about how he will restore our economy.
Amen.
And what he's going to do. And there's a special connection I've been telling your pastors that this word has with California.
Yes.
Because it really all began with me out here in California about a year and a half ago.
Right.
Now, I'll talk more probably about this tonight, but I was down at Fresno Fire, that revival, Todd Bentley, for 3 days. How many of you guys got to attend that in 2015 there? And I was just here for 3 days, and that was right when he ordained me just days before in Alaska. And then I got on the plane in Fresno to leave, go back up to Alaska, because we were preparing to move down south, my family. And when I got on the plane, an angel of the Lord appeared to be on the airplane, right? That's what I want, amen. Turn off the TV screen and just have a vision, praise God. And this angel says, I am the messenger of money. He says, everywhere you go, I'm going to pay your way. How many guys like that word?
Amen.
Well, I'm telling you, you have that word right now. Here it is. I give it to you.
Amen.
So it wasn't a word for me. It was a word for the body. It says, everywhere you go, I'm going to pay your way. And when you come back from that place, you'll come back with a bag full of money.
Amen.
Kind of a funny expression. But, you know, I wanted to know, well, how big is the bag? We're talking like, you know, a little knapsack? Or I'm like Santa Claus. But it was a statement that the Lord has since expounded upon. And he says, the church is not going to continue to have a dream and have a vision and not have the provision to walk the vision. That's not the Lord. It's not the Lord that you should pursue your dream in God and get into thousands of dollars of debt. And then the call of God becomes a burden to you rather than a blessing. That's not the call of God. That's not the will of God.
There you go.
And, you know, because Jesus is the richest man that has ever lived. I tell people if they have a problem with money, they have a problem with Jesus. Because he's the richest man that's ever lived. But because you are co-inheritor with him, so are you.
Amen.
You're the richest man and the richest woman in existence.
Amen?
So what am I saying? I'm saying that you have the inheritance. You have access to every last dime that you'll ever need, even more than that, because the nature of the kingdom is overflow. The nature of the kingdom is not just fill your belly, but leave baskets left over. Amen? Baskets left over. So, ever since that encounter I had in Fresno, this whole realm has opened. There ain't no way I could possibly get to it all in two services. I've written two books, you know, nearly 100,000 words per me. Which, you know, those books will be coming out soon. But I want to open up some more of that tonight, because there's been an incredible realm of glory that's come out of that when I've shared that word. We've seen people, even in California, become millionaires overnight. After receiving an impartation of his word. We've seen people given houses they didn't build, businesses they didn't start. Does that sound familiar to anybody? The children of Israel, they came to possess their inheritance. He said, I'll give you houses you didn't build, vineyards you didn't plant, wells you didn't dig. Oh, hallelujah. Fill that pentecostal of glory. Praise God. So we'll talk about all that glory, exposure stuff. And I may even hoop a little bit and get in my Pentecost. Amen. So you're not going to want to miss tonight. But let me just close with this. And I'm going to invite Pastor back up. Genesis 37. Joseph could not begin to go down his path. He could not begin to go down, you know, that call until he began to dream.
Yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah.
And what are the dreams that he began to dream? They were the dreams of the king. Right?
Yeah.
In both dreams, he saw his brothers and his mother and his father bowing to him. And it wasn't an arrogant thing. It was just a revelation of the kingship of heaven that God would reveal through this man. And it was for everybody's benefit. Amen? But when God begins to reveal a level, the manifestation of Christ's kingship through you, yeah, there's some people around you that might get jealous.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Things not, you know, may not, you know, go perfect at first. But I'm telling you, in due time, the word will produce.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
So I want to encourage you with that. As God releases this realm of glory, as God awakens you, you see, 2017 is a year that many people are going to step more in their kingly anointing, their dominion anointing, than they ever have before. But be prepared, because there might be some brothers that, you know, might not like it. Right? But really, it's not flesh and blood that we battle against.
Right.
It's principalities, powers, spiritual forces, right?
Right.
It's the enemy. Ultimately, the enemy fears more than anything you catching hold of the kingly mantle of Christ.
Yes.
If you catch hold of that kingly mantle of Christ, then his days are truly numbered.
Right.
His days are truly numbered.
Yeah.
So we have authority over him. Amen?
Right.
He's been placed firmly beneath our feet.
Right.
For a good stomp. I want to see him stomped. Not just in revival meetings. I want to see him stomped in the political realm.
Thank you.
I want to see him stomped in the financial realm.
Yeah.
But God is awakening the body of Christ right now to begin the king, to begin to dream the dream of a king.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
And that is going to bring forth, that is going to open up a gate which will never be shut, in which the King of glory will come.
Oh.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Just lift your hands just like this. Say, Father, we receive.
Father, we receive.
Father, we receive. Lord, we're hungry for it, Lord. We're hungry for that level of manifestation. We're hungry for a new level of manifestation, Lord. We don't just want to point to a scripture and say, hallelujah, I agree. We want to point to the scriptures and say, I believe and I receive.
Now,
let the manifestation of that which I believe come forth. Lord, I even come into agreement right now with all the prophecies, with all the words that have come forth, even in this congregation, even in this valley, even in this golden state of California, I come into agreement. And Lord, we say, we believe the word of the Lord. We will not receive the word of the enemy. No matter how negative it may be, no matter how many facts he may have found, we believe the word of the Lord. And Lord, we say, let there be a manifestation come forth of that word. The word of revival. The word of reformation, Lord God. Lord, I declare over this state right now, this is a glory state. This is a state of the anointing. This is a state where God starts things that go around the world and forever change the expression of what we call things. Lord, I thank you for the anointing that's on this state, Lord. I draw from that anointing right now. I come into agreement with that word right now that you've spoken, Lord. And we just say yes, Lord. We say yes, Lord. We say the kingdom of God is advancing. 2017, the Hebrew year 5777. There's come a completion. There's come a fullness of time. There's come a perfection to the divine order and the divine purpose of God. Lord, we say let the harvest on those seeds come forth in this land. Lord, I call forth the harvest right now. Seeds of revival. Seeds of revival. Seeds of revival. Lord, because you're moving in this state in financial glory. And Lord, I thank you that as you move in financial glory, you take back from the enemy what he was never meant to possess. And you equip, you strengthen the body of Christ to move forward in the harvest, to move forward in taking dominion over the garden that you've given them to have dominion in. You said to Adam, take dominion.
fresh bread. We need fresh visitation. We need a fresh visitation, God, of the manifest presence.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, we need a fresh visitation for our children, Lord.
Yes, God.
We need a fresh touch, Lord. But Lord, we just say this morning, Lord, we're hungry. Lord, we're hungry. And Lord, we commit. We're going to be hungry. We're going to stay hungry. And Lord, we just say, fill us. Fill us. Come on, say that with me, saints. Fill me, Lord. Fill me, Lord. Fill me, Lord, with your goodness. Fill me, Lord, with your abundance. Fill me to overflow. Fill me to overflow. In 2017, Lord. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we know we have the petitions that we ask of you. We thank you, Lord, that when we pray, we believe that we receive. Mark 11:24. We prophesy once again, Lord. 2017, the greatest year of glory we've ever seen.
Yeah.
The greatest year of the manifestation of the King of Glory,
year of glory
that we've ever seen. Lord, open up those gates. Be lifted up, you doors. And let the King of Glory come in. Let the King of Glory come in. He's strong and mighty. He's mighty in battle. He's the Lord of hosts. He is the King of Glory. Lord, we profess today that you are King today. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. You're King today. And we receive you as King today, Lord. We say yes to your kingship, Lord. We expect the kingship of Christ, Lord, in this place, in our lives. And if you agree with that, saints, just shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give the Lord another mighty shout.